Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us this evening. This is the Board of Directors agenda for the Wednesday, September 15th, 2021, Denver Regional Council of Governments Board meeting. I'm DRCOG Board Chair Ashley Stolzman, and because of COVID-19, this meeting's being held electronically and is being recorded. So I'll call the meeting to order, and I'll turn it over to Melinda Stevens and ask if we could please have a roll call and introduction of any new members or alternates.
Thank you, Madam Chair. We do have one new member to announce for the city of Littleton. The new representative is Mayor Jerry Valdez. So Mayor Valdez, if you have joined us, welcome and thank you for being a part of this. And with that, I'll go ahead and start our roll. All right, Aaron Brockett of Boulder.
Present.
Adam Cushing of Brighton.
Present.
Allison Coombs of Aurora. Mike Kaufman of Aurora. Anita Seitz of Westminster. Lindsay Smith of Westminster. Bill Gipp of Erie. Sarah Laughlin of Erie. Bill Van Meter of RTD. Bob Pfeiffer of Arvada. John Marriott of Arvada. Bud Starker of Wheat Ridge.
You be here.
Thank you. Claire Levy of Boulder County. Matt Jones of Boulder County. Colleen Whitlow of Meade.
Present.
David Spellman of Blackhawk. Deborah Mulvey of Castle Pines.
Here.
Don Cognac of Firestone. George Lance of Greenwood Village. Dave Kerber of Greenwood Village. George Teal of Douglas County. Abe Layden of Douglas County. Jacob LeBure of Lakewood.
Here.
Thank you so much. Jim Dale of Golden.
Here.
Jim Kumerly of Lockbuoy. Jamie Jeffrey of Lockbuoy. Jason Gray of Castle Rock.
Here.
Jeff Baker of Arapahoe County. Bill Holland of Arapahoe County. Jerry Valdez of Littleton. Pamela Grove of Littleton. Jessica Sandgren of Thornton.
I'm here.
Joan Peck of Longmont.
Here.
John Dyack of Parker.
Here.
Josie Cockrell of Foxfield. Lisa Jones of Foxfield.
Julie. I'm sorry, I didn't unmute. I'm here.
Oh, okay. Josie thank Cockrell. You.
Thank you.
Appreciate that. Thank you. Julie Duran Mullica of Northland. Kara Tanucci of Central City. Jeremy Fay of Central City. Catherine Whitman of Decono. Jackie Thomas of Decono. Kevin Flynn of Denver.
Here.
Christopher Larson of Nederland. Larry Vittem of Bennett.
Here.
Linda Montoya of Federal Heights. Celeste Arner of Federal Heights. Linda Olson of Inglewood.
Here.
Lynette Kelsey of Georgetown.
Here.
Margot Ramsden of Bomar. Michael Hillman of Idaho Springs. Neil Shaw of Superior. Tim Howard of Superior.
Sorry, this is Neil. I didn't hit you quick enough.
Nope, that's okay. I'm sorry. Thank you so much. Nicholas Angelo of Lyons. Holly Rogan of Lyons. Nicholas Williams of Denver.
Here.
Nicole Frank of Commerce City.
Present.
Paul Sutton of Morrison. Sean Foray of Morrison. Rachel Binkley of Glendale. Ryan Toucher of Glendale. Randy Wheel of Cherry Hills Village.
Here, happy to be here.
Thank you. Randy Wheelock of Clear Creek County. George Marlin of Clear Creek County. Rebecca White of CDOT.
Here.
Roy Palmer of Columbine Valley. Gail Christie of Columbine Valley. Sally Daigle of Sheridan. Stephanie Walton of Lafayette.
Hello.
Steve Odoricio of Adams County.
Here.
Steve Conklin of Edgewater.
Here.
Tammy Maurer of Centennial.
Present.
Tracy Kraft Tharp of Jefferson County.
Here.
Webb Sill of Gilpin County. William Lindstedt of Broomfield.
Here.
Wynn Shaw of Lone Tree.
Present.
All right. And if there's anyone that's still left over in the attendee side that is a board member, if you'd please raise your hand so we can bring you over.
And Melinda, clearly we've Boulder County present.
If we could have order, could we please have order for just a second? There's going to be a number of people who didn't get to say here. And so if we could just have everyone who is a panelist that wasn't able to say they were here, just raise your hand so we can get you marked down, because there were about 10 or 12 people, I believe. So that way we can get through that and just make sure we get the mark. So we have George Teal, the person who's listed as counsel. Could we just hear who you are so we can get you renamed?
Mike Kaufman.
Thank you, Mayor Kaufman. So we have George Teal, Mike Kaufman, Cheryl Wink, Claire Levy, Bill Van Meter, Anita Seitz, all marked here now. And if someone on staff can please rename Mayor Kaufman, and then the person named TKTH, if you could just unmute and then we can get you renamed with your name.
Tracy Crossart.
Thank you very much.
And
we have Linda Montoya also here, and I'll promote you over to panelists. Great. Is anyone else not been able to raise their hand or been moved over to panelists properly? Great. Thank you, everyone. See, that's taken care of. So now we're on to approval of the agenda. Could I please get a motion to approve the agenda? I lost my participants. Great. Director Teal.
Move to approve the agenda.
Thank you. Is there a second? Director Shaw.
I second that.
Thank you very much. Any discussion of approving the agenda?
This is the consent agenda with the,
No, it's not. No, it's not. And I'll get to that in a second.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
No problem at all. All those in favor, please say
aye.
Aye.
Thank you. The motion carries. Those opposed? Thank you, everyone. The motion carries. All right, back on track. That takes us to the report of the chair. And I have nothing to report, but I will turn it over to the Performance and Engagement Committee for a report there.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. And thanks to the Performance and Engagement Committee. We met on September 1st and had a couple of items we discussed. I think everyone knows that we had to delay the workshop that we had intended to do in August. So we talked about those topics and gave advice to staff on what of those topics could be worked in elsewhere and what may be looked at as we move ahead to planning a workshop in 22. We also followed up on the DRCOG Executive Director Annual Performance Evaluation Process. And with that, I will let you know that tomorrow you will get an email from Dr. Cog that is the review, is the performance evaluation for Director Doug Rex. And we would ask that you complete that. It's very important. A part of the overall process as we work to evaluate his performance and take the action steps as a part of that process. So you'll get that email tomorrow and you'll have a couple weeks to do it. Why wait a couple of weeks? Do it when you get it. And we appreciate your help. And with that, that's my report.
Thank you, Director Conklin. And next, a report from the Finance and Budget Committee.
Thank you, Madam Chair. In this evening's Finance and Budget Committee, we approved two resolutions authorizing the Executive Director to accept funds for $80,000 from the City of Aurora to support transportation for older adult residents, and also to distribute approximately $580,000 in 2022 Nutrition Service Incentive Program, also known as NSIP funds. That is my report. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Director Shaw. And that takes us to the report of the Executive Director.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And good evening to everybody. First, I would like to just to thank you all very much for those who had an opportunity to complete the collaboration assessment. I know it's a slog, but that information truly is valuable for ourselves and the Performance and Engagement Committee to help improve this collaborative we call Dr. Cog. So thank you all so very, very much. And I know the ink is just drying on that collaboration assessment. And as Chair Conklin mentioned, we'll be sending out my performance review survey tomorrow morning. So we appreciate your patience and having to fill out a number of these surveys. But hopefully that one won't take you as long as the collaboration assessment did. Let me see. Bike to Work Day is a week away from today, September 22nd. And while we're not expecting the 30 plus thousand that we typically have for our normal Bike to Work Day during the summer, we are expecting thousands of people to help us celebrate biking in the region. We'll still have hundreds of breakfast stations from around the region that are typically open between 6 and 9 a.m. And even we'll have a few bike from work parties as well that will be scattered throughout the region. Our own Way to Go team will be hosting a breakfast station at 14th and Bannock, right out front of the City County building. So please, if you're interested in where some of those breakfast stations might be located, please visit our website, and you'll be able to find the ones that are closest to you. Let me see here. So just as we're wrapping up Bike to Work Day, our Way to Go staff will be working on this year's annual Go-tober event. And this is a business competition to help reduce vehicle miles of travel and reduce single occupancy use. We do this during the month of October. We've been doing it for, I wish I could see Steve Erickson, I think six years now, with quite a bit of success. Our Way to Go team provides a turnkey package to support resources to large employers then promote commute options in the workplace. So we're excited about this again this year, and I'll be providing some additional information in my next on board newsletter. So stay tuned on that. DOLA grants. You remember last month I mentioned that there's a current grant opportunity available through the Department of Local Affairs to assist local governments in development of innovative solutions to promote the development of affordable housing across the state. You should have received an email from us shortly after, later on in the week, after I made that announcement. But just as a reminder that the deadline for that application is September 20th, which is Monday. And we know several of your staff have reached out to our staff just to talk about that. You're thinking about submitting to that. So just please put a rush on that. We'd like to get as many applications throughout the region as possible. And after the deadline, DOLA will still be receiving applications and they'll review those on a rolling basis. They suggested that they'll be reviewing those once a month, but it's limited funding, right? It's first come, first serve after that. So please be conscious of the deadlines. The last thing, Madam Chair, I would like to mention is I would like to draw your attention to an informational item that's in the packet this evening. It's item number 12. And it provides a summary of the latest developments on the Front Range passenger rail activities. But of note in the memo and in the corresponding PowerPoint, it mentions the staff has had a conversation with the Performance and Engagement Committee about a process for the selection of Dr. Cog's representatives to the Front Range Passenger Rail District Board that was created through Senate Bill 238. We know there's been a number of questions and about what our process will be related to that. And we're gonna provide you a lot more detail about this next month. Quite frankly, we didn't have time to get it in the agenda this month with the greenhouse gas emission discussion. So we wanted to share that with you as an information item. But the Performance Engagement Committee, their suggestion is to utilize our nominating committee to make those recommendations of those four representatives to the commission district board. But those appointments we must be made by March 1st. So we have a bit of time. So we're gonna wait, and our suggestion is to wait until the new nominating committee is seated in November. So more on that next month. But again, I just wanted to share that with you because I know there have been questions. Madam Chair, that's my report.
Thank you, Executive Director Rex. That takes us to our public comment period. Up to 45 minutes is now allocated for public comment, and each speaker will be limited to 3 minutes. If there are additional requests from the public to address the board, time will be allocated at the end of the meeting to complete public comment. I would request that there's no public comment for an issue which a prior public hearing has been held before the board, and we'll start with consent and action items right after public comment. Our first member up tonight is Randall. Good evening.
Good evening, Randall Loeb, advocate on issues of poverty. I'm working in a new program. I'm really happy to report in Jefferson County to take care of the gaps that exists in housing. James Ginsburg, who was the initial director for Fort Lyon, as well as the director for Housing First, in the very beginning iteration of my work in the community, founded Recovery Works Today at 7011 West Colfax at the Jefferson Action Center's emergency shelter. I'm the day coordinator on weekends. I'm very happy to be involved in direct services for people who do not have places to live. I am always saying that we need to create permanent supportive housing with wraparound services, and we are going to do that. We have a pipeline with Fort Lyon because James was the first director of that, and we're really excited to be developing more resources for Jefferson County, but they will be also available, it seems to me, for our region. We need to come up with plans that basically help us to work together to create strategies for people to be safe and to also have behavioral health healing and recovery and trauma care. And that's one of the most important things that I think as a region we should be collaborating on, no matter where we are. And being an old head from a suburb in the East, I really feel honored to be able to be a part of such a proposal and such work. The other thing that's on my agenda tonight is the appointment of Chantel Lewis, who is a wonderful addition to RTD. She worked for the Colorado Coalition in Inclusiveness and the cultural diversity, and will be an incredible asset to developing new strategies in terms of making sure that all people have an access to safe rail and safe bus lanes and safe places to go. But I'm really feeling like in my 70s, I'm just beginning in my expedition to achieve what it is that I started out to do when I was one of the writers for the Denver Voice newspaper in the 1990s. You have a great night, and
Thank you, Mr. Loeb, for your comments this evening. And it's my understanding that some members may be having trouble raising their hands. So just a reminder, the raise hand feature can be found at the bottom of your panel by clicking on raise hand. And if you've dialed in by phone, you can dial star 9. So next up for public comment, we have Travis Madsen.
Hi, thank you for the opportunity to speak tonight. My name is Travis Madsen. I'm here tonight speaking as a resident of Denver, but I'm also the Transportation Program Director at the Southwest Energy Efficiency Project and a member of the Transportation Subcommittee of the Denver Sustainability Advisory Council. I'm also a new parent to a daughter. I'm here to urge you to support the transportation planning pollution standard that's currently under consideration at the Transportation Commission. I think that we're preventing the worst impacts of climate change should be among the very top priorities for local governments in the region and across the nation and across the world. Every year I see more reason for urgency. This year, as I'm sure you all noticed, our air was choked with wildfire smoke most of the summer. Lake Mead reached a historically low water level, raising the possibility of major disruptions in Western agriculture. Last year, the fires were in our own backyard, and I'm worried about what we're going to see in future years. So we need to use every tool available that we have to reduce pollution. That means we need to, you know, make every vehicle run on renewable electricity, but that alone will not deliver the pollution reductions we need as fast as we need them. We also need to upgrade our community and build toward a future where we don't have to travel so far to get where we need to go, and where there are many more zero emission options to get around, including transit, biking, and walking. So we need to make every transportation planning decision with state climate goals in mind. I urge you, therefore, to support the proposed transportation rule and to ask CDOT to make it strong enough to actually reach the 2030 pollution reduction targets that the legislature set in House Bill 191261. To ask CDOT to ensure that this rule also provides real benefits to communities that have been left behind in past planning decisions. And finally, to ask CDOT to ensure that all the planning regions act now in unison to align their investments with climate protection. Thank you very much and appreciate the opportunity.
You're muted, Ashley.
Beautiful. Sorry about that, everyone. Next we have in the queue, Joanna Rosa Sands. Joanna, you should be able to unmute yourself and go ahead and tell us what you'd like to tell us.
Very important. You'll see Paola.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you so much. My name is Joanna Rosensteins. I am a resident of Denver, single mother of three elementary students, and I've been a Latina community organizer for the past 18 years. I am here with my mommy hat on and also here representing the will of the Latino people. I'm here because we're worried about the impacts of what would be happening, the increase of pollution, the noise, the traffic. We're already suffering from dirty air, children with asthma, people losing houses in Carmel City. And I'm worried about the expansion of I-270. I encourage you to speak to the greenhouse gas pollution standards rulemaking proposed by CDOT. I think that the DRCOG should embrace the proposed rules and make the provisions for reducing driving and pollution even stronger, something that I teach my kids all the time. And just please, I'm asking that you include our voices, the people's voices, as it's about equity and worrying about our community and just neighborhoods and our decisions. So that's it. Thank you so much for your time and thank you for listening.
Thank you. Next, we have 350 Colorado coordinators too.
Hi there, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
And sorry, actually, I must have logged in with another account, but I'm actually Brent Goodlett, and I'm here speaking on my own behalf, not on behalf of 350. My name is Brent Goodlett, and I'm a resident of Centennial and a climate and environmental justice advocate for the people of Colorado. And my comments today are on the greenhouse gas transportation rulemaking. First, I want to reiterate a point that I made at the previous DRCOG board work session, and that is the greenhouse gas reduction levels listed in the draft rules, specifically tables 1 and 2, are not sufficient to meet the state's greenhouse gas reduction roadmap as stipulated by HB 19-1261. The greenhouse gas roadmap says we need 12.7 million metric tons of CO2e reductions by 2030, yet the numbers in the draft rules only add up to 11.67 million metric tons. That's over 1 million metric tons short. The people of Colorado that DRCOG represents deserve a clear plan for achieving the state's climate targets, not more accounting tricks. The emissions reductions targets don't add up to the levels required, then the GHG transportation rule is doomed to be a failure from day one. The people of Colorado are watching this rulemaking, and they are demanding bold climate action commensurate with the best available science. And they're tired of all of these half measures and accounting tricks that set up our children and future generations to suffer a cruel and dark future of climate catastrophe after climate catastrophe. The window to act on climate is closing. We are quickly approaching a series of one-way doors that once passed through will lock us, that will lock behind us and lock us into a terrible future of climate warming and untold levels of suffering. We can and we must act now. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Thank you everyone for taking the time to comment to us this evening. I appreciate it and the board appreciates it. And that will take us to our next agenda item, which is our consent agenda. I understand there may be some discussion on this agenda item. And so if anyone, just as a reminder, we normally don't put so many action items and this type of material on the consent agenda. But given the number of topics we had tonight, we did load it up. So if there are any things people would like to remove from the consent agenda or any discussion of consent agenda items that needs to happen, this would be the time for that. Director Gray.
Oh, thank you very much. I'd like to remove 7-4. I believe it's CDOT. Is that correct, Ashley?
So that is the Transportation Improvement Program TIP amendments, and I'll look to Executive Director Rex and just ensure that that is the correct item. Yes, that's right.
Yeah, so in Castle Rock, it's actually in a donut hole in Castle Rock. It's part of Douglas County. It's not Castle Rock. It's really our least spot that we'd like to have it, and we can't support it.
Okay, so we'll go ahead and remove that from the consent agenda and put it on the regular agenda right after consent and have that discussion then. Are there any other topics people need to remove from the consent agenda? So I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda as amended, which removes item 4 from the consent agenda. Is there a second? Director Flynn.
Certainly, Chair. I will second that motion to approve the consent agenda minus item 7-4.
Thank you. Any other discussion of the consent agenda? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you, everyone. The motion carries. And so that takes us to our first item, which will be the FY 2022 to 2025 Transportation Improvement Program Amendment. It's attachment D in your packet. And I'll turn it over to Executive Director Rex to introduce the topic or to turn it over to a staff member to take us through that.
Great. Thank you, Madam Chair. Taka Trail, should I turn it to you or to Mr. Schwenk. Can Todd speak, Melinda? There he is.
Yes, sorry. I'll actually turn it over to Josh. I think he's prepared on this item.
Great. Mr. Schwenk, if you'll just take us briefly through this topic and then we'll turn it over to Director Gray to let us know what he'd like to tell us.
Sure. So
just running quickly, we do have six proposed amendments to the Transportation Improvement Program. The first would be a new design pool in Region 1, which includes six pool projects for a total of $10.5 million. Next would be a new Region 4 Mobility Hub pool. This includes one mobility hub at Firestone Longmont for a total of $13 million. The next project would be a new project for intersection improvements at SH7 and 95th Street. This is part of the overall SH7 corridor improvements. And the total for that project would be $13.438 million. The next item on the amendments is actually just an adjustment to the RPP pool, which adds that previous project, which we just discussed, to the RPP pool. There are RPP funds included in that SH7 project, so it is just for tracking purposes that it would be in the pool. There are no additional funds being added. The next project would add $20 million in state legislative funding to the I-70 noise walls project for additional phases of work on that. And finally, there are several adjustments to the Region 1 Mobility Hub pool, including two new pool projects for the Castle Rock Mobility Hub and a busing maintenance facility, and an increase in funds on the other two projects. Totals an increase of $19.3 million.
Thank you, Mr. Schwenk. And so I'll turn it over to Director Gray.
Thank you, I appreciate it. I'd like to take off the number four on that. It's just it's not going to work for us, and it's really not going to work for CDOT either. I mean, there'll be no access to it except from the highway. There would be no access to it from Castle Rock whatsoever, and it feels like it's money not well spent. I know it's only $300,000, but it's still $300,000 that we don't think that should be spent there.
Thanks, Director Gray. And we have Rebecca White, director from CDOT. Rebecca, go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. I wanted to provide a bit of perspective on this project from the CDOT end. And Chair, I wonder if Melinda might be able to enable the microphone for Mike Timlin with our Division of Transit and Rail so that he might answer any questions as well. Is that possible?
Yep, we'll just move him over to panelists right now.
Okay, so I'll start out here just for a bit of background on the board. This is for the board. This is a relatively small amount of money given the total expected cost for this mobility hub, which I believe is a bit over $10 million. So the commitment here is more to keep the conversations and the early design and analysis work going. There has not been a final location determined for this hub. We continue to be in conversations both with the city and the county and expect to continue to do those. I think CDOT is interested in a certain location, but we have not made a final decision. I want to be very clear on that. So these dollars do not tie us to any specific location, but they do enable ongoing analysis. Mike Timlin, I invite you to expand on or correct anything I've said there.
No, that's absolutely no. That's correct, Rebecca. Thank you for that. Basically, we back in November we released kind of a draft analysis of the four alternatives that we've been working on, and we have. One of the things basically we're looking at transit operations, vision and goals of the mobility hub program, site constraints, travel patterns, regional connectivity, and all, you know, and scored them all. We do have one alternative. It is not within the city limits. It's in the unincorporated Douglas County. Right now, that is going through. That site is going through, a process within the county itself. One of the things we look at is efficient transit travel through the corridor. The one Walker Pine Canyon site is compatible for a center loading station, much like what we're building in Loveland and in Berthoud right now, where the bus never leaves the highway, pulls off into the center median at a center loading station, loads people up in the center of the freeway, and then continues on, taking about 5 minutes of time to do all of that. The other options that we have from an operational standpoint, the Miller's Landing and the Wolfsenberger have some unique problems with it. Miller's Landing, we'd have to completely get off the highway.
Michael, I might come back to you for this level of detail, but I think we might be getting into a level of detail that's beyond what's necessary for this conversation.
Okay. Well, anyway, very good.
Director White, if I could just turn back to you, if you could just very briefly tell everyone what we're talking about with mobility hubs. I just don't know that everybody is in as deep as some of us are. Director White, I don't know if you can hear me. We can't hear you, so we might come back to that, but it looks like
a central location to connect.
Oh, there you are.
Can you hear me now?
Now we can. We could not hear anything you said.
Oh, it was brilliant. Okay, shoot. Thank you. Sorry, I should have started with the concept of mobility hubs. So this is an investment category you'll see throughout the CDOT 10-year plan. And the concept here is that we invest in these hubs or nodes where you can tie in multiple different ways to travel. So it can be a place for both busing and local transit services to connect, a place to park your bike, a place to even charge your vehicle, and that it would really bring in both local and interstate transit services. So we are building a network of these along the spine of I-25 from pretty much the Wyoming border all the way down through Pueblo, and Castle Rock is certainly a key location for that.
Thank you. Director Teal?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, based upon the detail that was provided by Mr. Timlin, pertaining to the site being an active land use application with Douglas County, Colorado, I need to recuse myself and kind of, mute on my end this conversation. As much as I always like to support our mayors here in Douglas County, and especially my friend Jason Gray, I do need to recuse myself. Chair, may I please ask for a text?
Yes.
If not from you, then from the executive director, once we resume and conclude this.
I will text you when we conclude this topic. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve.
Are there any, I should have asked if there are any other recusals or folks who need to step out of this conversation. All right. So I just would like to frame this a little bit, and in whatever way this goes is perfectly fine, and it is the pleasure of the board. But my understanding is this is a project that's in the 10-year plan, the CDOT 10-year plan. And so this approval would basically be for design money so that CDOT could work with the stakeholders, whether it be Douglas County and Castle Rock and commuter agencies and things like that, to determine a location and the next steps on this project. Have I captured that right, Rebecca White?
Very well said, Chair, thank you.
So in that context, I wonder, Director Gray, if you have concerns about that, if the location hasn't been chosen, and if it is about design work and figuring out a location with you, or if that still causes you concern. I just want to clarify that. Director Gray.
Thank you, Chair. It still does cause us concern because we haven't had much luck on any other spots with CDOT. They seem to be really liking this spot. And they're correct, and it's a good spot as far as getting on and off the freeway. But there'll be no access from Castle Rock. No bicycle access, no car access, nothing from Castle Rock. So that's what I'm trying to put across, is there'll be no way to access it from Castle Rock. So that's unfortunate.
So I'm not seeing other hands in the queue. I believe the proposal, and my screen, I have it zoomed into the project plan, unfortunately, but I believe what I understood the proposal then would be from Director Gray would be to approve the TIP amendments, excluding the amendment that would add the region. Sorry, if you could scroll up just the slightest bit on whoever's screen sharing, then I can pick the right project. I guess it's a component of the Region 1 Mobility Hub pool, but not the entire thing. Is that right, Director Gray?
Yes, Chair, I appreciate that.
All right, any other, Director Gray, would you consider just making that in the form of the motion so that we can debate the motion more clearly?
Yeah, I can't read, unfortunately, my screen, but I would like to take out the that section of the TIP for Castle Rock.
Great, thank you. Is there a second? So the motion is to approve the TIP projects, but to remove that one project from the pool of projects. I see a number of hands. I don't know. They did precede me asking for a second. So if you don't mind putting your hand down for just one second, if you're not planning on seconding. Director Mulvey. Oh, sorry about that. I was too fast. You're muted.
I'm happy to second, but I did also request to involve myself.
Great, so there's now a motion on the table, and so discussion of the motion. Director Mulvey.
Thank you. Yeah, my concern has to do with what Mayor Director Gray just mentioned, and so therefore I would have a question. If there's no access from the abutting municipality for this mobility hub, being a very close neighbor, where then would people gain the use from this mobility hub? What would be the purpose and what would be the method of transit if we can't use it from that one municipality? I obviously would have residents that are driving to this location. What could they pick up there and what's the purpose of it? Is it a true multi-mobility hub or can that be elucidated somehow, please?
Director White, could you help us out a little bit with this?
I'd like to, but I may have to turn to Mike Timlin for a bit more details. I know we would definitely have the Bustang stop at this location, but Mike, could you help answer the director's remaining questions?
Certainly. I can also say, that hopefully that Front Range passenger rail in the future will also serve it. And one of the criteria we were looking at is that, where would, a location where it could also be a bus and a rail stop. Now, currently, I have to disagree. There is access from Liggett Road that extends down from on the west side from Santa Fe Drive, and on the east side along the frontage Wilcox Road there's near Douglas County High School, there'd be access, we would work on access from that side also.
Thanks. Director Brackett.
Yes, I appreciate Director Gray raising these concerns. I do think, though, that there's a real value to having that network of mobility hubs going up and down I-25 in an unbroken line. So what I wonder is if we could maybe come out of this with approving the original proposal, but really asking CDOT to collaborate with the local jurisdictions to find the solution that's amenable, the most amenable to all the jurisdictions in the area, so that we could get that mobility hub as part of that network, but also deal with some of the concerns that have been raised.
Thank you, Director Brackett. Director Gray?
Thank you. I have to disagree with Michael about that. We would not allow access from Liggett or from the frontage road. That's the point I'm trying to get across, is we would not do that. We would not allow access. It's in a black hole of Castle Rock. It's in a weird area. It doesn't connect to downtown, doesn't connect to any of our our neighborhoods very well. It's just in a hard spot.
So I have a question, Director White, for you. Is this, would it be possible for CDOT to work with the locals in this area and then bring this particular one back to us at a future meeting, or is this a time-sensitive decision?
I can answer that. It's a time-sensitive decision because we're using SB 267 money, which has a time limit.
That's true, Mike. However, I would note if the chair is talking about perhaps just an additional month, I think that might be good for us to have additional conversations with the city and return this one to the board next month. Mike, if you could just confirm that a 30-day delay would be acceptable.
Oh, sure.
Yeah,
absolutely. 30 days would be fine. I'm looking at the grand scope of when the funding expires.
Yep. So Chair, if that's your suggestion, we would be happy to continue conversations with the city.
I would encourage the board to go in that direction because then the stakeholders involved can get their questions answered and work together. And so if we approve the rest of the pool tonight, it doesn't delay any of those projects and it still leaves this one on the table to come back to us at a future meeting. So that is the current motion on the table, and we would also give staff direction to have Dr. Cog staff ensure that that conversation happens and is facilitated. Director Sykes.
My apologies. I thought I lowered hand. I like this proposal to
come back. All right. And then Director Papsdorf.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Ron Papsdorf, Director of Transportation Planning and Operations. I did just want to clarify one thing. This is a Metropolitan Planning Organization decision, an MPO decision by the Dr. Cog Board. Those decisions do require the consent of both the Regional Transportation Committee and the Board of Directors. The RTC did recommend approval of this package, as did TAC. Totally no problem with the board taking a different direction. But it will need to cycle back through the RTC to concur with this decision. So just want to make sure the board is understands that. Again, not a problem for us. We can accommodate that.
Thank you for making us aware of that, Director Papsdorf. Director Flynn.
Thank you, Chair. Doug or Ron, maybe you could clarify then, if the motion is to remove this particular item from being considered and bringing it back possibly in a month. Based on what Ron just said, does that mean that the board cannot consider the entire set of five or so TIP amendments because the RTC approved them as a package? Or would the board act and approve all of the ones minus this one here in Castle Rock and the other three locations with it.
Mr. Papsdorf.
Madam Chair, Director Flynn, the whole package will have to cycle back through RTC and come back to the board.
Okay, so the motion on the table really should be modified to just remove the entire, not just the Castle Rock and Lone Tree and the other two, the Bustang, the four projects there, but the entire item needs to be removed.
No. Okay. So let me just clarify, Director Flynn. Any modification we make from what the RTC approved would have to go back to the RTC. So if we modify it at all, it will have to go to the RTC. But we can do what has been proposed in the motion this evening. It's just that the RTC then will have to vote on exactly what we approve and just determine as an RTC if they approve that as well, because our votes have to match.
All right, thank you.
That's correct.
So the motion on the table is to approve. Oh, geez, my computer moved. No. Oh, geez. I apologize, everyone. I have all my screens set up, and if something goes wrong, it's no good. All right. So the motion on the table is to approve the FY 2022 to 2025 Transportation Improvement Program amendments, but to exclude the Castle Rock Mobility Hub project funding from the amendments and to give staff direction to help facilitate a discussion between CDOT and the communities in that area to reach some consensus before bringing it back to the board. So that is the motion that's on the table. Any further discussion of the motion before we vote? Director Brackett.
Well, thanks for that, Madam Chair. If my direction might be a little bit different, which would be to make every effort to come to an accommodation with the local governments, but to bring back the proposal kind of in whatever state it lands with after the discussions are had. And then we could vote, and the board could at its discretion approve or deny it at that point.
Can you just explain slightly differently how that's different than what I was trying to word?
I think, as I understood what you said, is to reach consensus and then bring it back to the board. Consensus would be ideal, but may not be achievable. So what I'm saying is to do the best to come to the most satisfactory conclusion with all the jurisdictions and then bring it back to us kind of to where they get it after that month-long discussion period.
Thank you. Does the mover, Jason, Director Gray, do you concur with that as a friendly amendment?
That's a friendly amendment I can live with, thank you.
And the seconder, Director Mulvey, do you concur with that as a friendly amendment?
Yes, I do.
All right, thank you. Thank you, everyone. Any other discussion of the motion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you, everyone. The motion carries, and I will let Director Teal back in. Thank you, Director Teal. And we will just get started on the next item, which is Dr. Cog's Title VI Implementation Plan, Limited English Proficiency Plan, and Americans with Disabilities Act Program Access Plan. It's attachment E in your packet, and I'll turn it over to Alvin Vidal Sanchez, our transportation planner in transportation planning and operations. Hi, Alvin.
Hi, Chair. Thank you so much. So I'm coming before you with our three plans that make up Dr. Cog's core non-discrimination program. As an agency that receives federal funding, we're required to adhere to various non-discrimination statutes. So each of these plans applies to a key non-discrimination statute. We've been working on these plans since May. We had an initial kickoff internally with staff to make sure we understood the scope of what these plans are going to look like. And then we also had an external coordination meeting with Federal Highway, Federal Transit, and CDOT to make sure we were all on the same page, make sure we had all the guidance we needed to make sure we were making these plans to the best they could be. We had a public review period through the month of July that included reviews by CDOT, RTD, Federal Highway, and FTA. We've been addressing comments and going through our committees since then, and we're all moving forward to our federal deadline of October 1st to have these approved and submitted to the Federal Transit Administration. A key component of the update to these three plans was looking at what other MPOs around the nation are doing. We looked at our fellow MPOs in Colorado, some other national MPOs just to see how they were approaching these topics. We also wanted to make sure we were looking at other MPOs that are Federal Transit Administration 5310 direct recipients, just like we most recently are. Just wanted to see how they were approaching their FTA requirements, how we could also approach those and make sure we were approaching them appropriately. Our first plan is the Title VI Implementation Plan. It's our most expansive plan. It demonstrates that we as an agency have the procedures and the resources in place to make sure we're providing all of our services in a non-discriminatory manner. It documents all the related activities that have been conducted over the previous 3 years, especially how our major plans and programs take into consideration Title VI. And it's also a way that we inform the public and our recipients of the process we use to make sure that our programs, projects, and the recipients themselves are in compliance with Title VI. A key piece is a demographic profile of the Denver region. It uses the same 7 vulnerable populations that we used for the 2050 RTP: individuals of color, low-income households, individuals with limited English proficiency, adults age 65 and older, children age 5 to 17, individuals with a disability, and households without a motor vehicle. On your screen is a 2-page spread showing maps for 2 of those particular vulnerable populations. In the plan, we've mapped each of those 7 vulnerable populations using census tract data. So you can see the geographic distribution of each of those 7 vulnerable populations across the region. The plan also takes that a step further and performs a transportation investment analysis. So we look at the short-term investments that are occurring in our 2022 to 2025 transportation improvement program and overlay that where there are concentrations of those particular vulnerable populations. On your screen is a two-page spread example showing households without a motor vehicle. Households without a motor vehicle make up about 5% of the region's households. So on the map on the right page, any census tracts where that is above 5% are highlighted in teal. And then you can see in orange are the TIP projects that have been overlaid so we can perform a visual check of the investments that are occurring throughout the region and see how those compare. There's a two-page spread like this for each of those seven vulnerable populations that I just mentioned. Like I mentioned, it's our most expansive plan, so we also outline our policies and procedures. That includes our meeting accommodation language, what we're able to provide the public if they request assistance. We look at how our board and committees are structured. There are seven staff divisions at DRCOG, so we outline the major plans and programs each of them completes and how Title VI is taken into account. A new piece is our subrecipient monitoring. Now that we're awarding federal funding to grantees, we're making sure they are also in compliance with Title VI. The plan outlines the data that's available to local governments as well as staff and how that's used to identify the needs of vulnerable populations. And there's also a summary of public participation over the last 3 years for our major plans and programs. Our second plan is the Limited English Proficiency Plan. The goal of this plan is to make sure that we're including all residents in our activities to the maximum extent practicable. To do that, it outlines how individuals who may need language assistance are identified, the ways we provide that assistance, and how we let them know that there is assistance available. We also describe any staff training that's required just so staff in the office know what's available to them online, over the phone, and even in the office if they need to engage with someone who speaks a language other than English. Just as the Title VI plan had a demographic profile, the LEP plan has a limited English proficiency assessment. Approximately 8% of the people in the region who are 5 years old or older are considered limited English proficient, or they speak English less than very well. The two-page spread on your screen shows a map looking at the geographic distribution of LEP individuals across the region. And then we also outline the top 10 non-English languages spoken in the region. The most spoken language is Spanish or Spanish Creole. In addition to the spread you see on your screen, we also include county level breakdowns. So you can see how each of those 10 languages fleshes out across your own county. There's also maps of the top 5 non-English languages, so you can see how different language groups cluster around the region. And there's also a map of English language learners by school district. That was the first factor and a 4-factor analysis that staff conducts to determine what are reasonable accommodations to provide. The second factor is the frequency with which LEP individuals come in contact with the program. That depends on the program or the division that we're looking at. As an example, our Way2Go program receives about 22 requests per year for assistance in a language other than English. Compare that to our Area Agency on Aging, which is about 6,700 requests per year. Factor 3 is the nature and importance of the program. DRCOG uses federal funding for short-range planning, long-range planning, as well as administering contracts for agencies that deliver meals across the region. And then the 4th factor, the resources that are available to DRCOG and the costs of those. So making sure that we have staff training available and staff are aware of the resources available to them to assist individuals who speak a language other than English when needed. Our last plan is the Americans with Disabilities Act Program Access Plan. It outlines the requirements that apply to DRCOG under the ADA and documents how we're making sure our programs, activities, and services are accessible to individuals with disabilities. It looks at our office space. While we don't own the building that DRCOG is located in, we do make sure any renovations or alterations are compliant with the ADA. We have features on our website that make it more accessible to individuals with disabilities, including being able to change the font size, adjust colors, adjust contrasts. We outline how our public meetings are accessible in terms of getting to a public meeting, participating in a public meeting, what accommodations we can provide. We outline how our planning process ensures the needs of individuals with disabilities are taken into account. And then a new piece, just as with the Title VI plan, is making sure our subrecipients or our grantees are also in compliance with the ADA. Like I mentioned, we had 30 days of public review. We ended up sending an e-blast out to over 2,400 contacts. We actually achieved a 36% open rate on that and had 161 total link clicks from the email. In terms of our social media, we had over 1,000 impressions across our different posts over the 30-day period. And we ended up getting about 110 web page hits just where the plans were sitting for that 30-day public review. Both the TAC and RTC have recommended adoption of the 3 non-discrimination plans. So we're before you today for that action. That'll get us to our final submittal deadline to the FTA of October 1st. even after the adoption and the submittal to FDA, Dr. Cog staff still have some discrete steps that we're looking at taking. We're looking at translating all three of our non-discrimination plans into Spanish. Last cycle, we did the LEP plan in Spanish. This cycle, we're looking at doing all three just so our core non-discrimination plans are available in a language other than English. We're currently developing accessibility procedures for our different products, including our videos, documents, and social media, making sure we're including alternative text, closed captioning, a large font where appropriate. And then there's our continuous review of our plans and programs and services to make sure we're in compliance with all of our non-discrimination and accessibility requirements. So the proposed motion is on your screen to frame the discussion, and I'm happy to answer any questions directors might have.
Thank you very much for all the work and the presentation. This was very professionally executed and a lot of work that you all have undertaken. And so we'll turn to Director Levy for a motion to frame the discussion and then any comments she'd like to make once we get a second.
Oh, actually, thank you, Madam Chair. I raised my hand to ask a question. I'm happy to put a motion on the table before I ask my question.
That would be great. Thank you.
All right, well then I move to adopt a resolution adopting the Title VI Implementation Plan and the Associated Limited English Proficiency Plan and the Americans with Disability Act Program Access Plan.
Is there a second, Director Conklin?
I second the motion.
Thank you, Director Levy?
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chair. And I appreciate all the work that's been done on this plan. I just wanted to make a comment or an observation, I think, and that is the use of the term vulnerable populations in conjunction with people of color, low-income households, individuals with limited English proficiency, et cetera. And that is that I guess I would hope that we could find a different term other than vulnerable. These are populations, groups of people that have many assets, and the quality that is identified is just one of them, which isn't necessarily a deficit. And the term vulnerable connotes a deficit and a degree of frailty that I think doesn't acknowledge the strengths of these populations. So I would hope that we could start shifting our language away from deficit terminology and towards strength terminology in the future. And that's all. That's my comment.
Thank you, Director Levy. Any other discussion or comments? Director Olson?
Thank you. If the chair wouldn't mind, I'd like to ask Board Member Levy what would be an alternative set of terms to use?
Director Levy?
Thank you, Madam Chair. I don't have another term right here, but these are populations that I imagine are identified in federal law that we need to accommodate when we come up with our Title VI implementation plans. So targeted populations, something that doesn't identify them in terms
something
of
deficit, less but evaluative in the term. I agree with where you're going with this, but I'm still searching for some terms that would help us understand some of what's at risk if we don't work on some of these things. But I agree that it can be a deficit-based term.
We have a comment offer of assistance.
Yeah, we don't take public comment just throughout the meeting, and we have a lot of topics to get through. But Executive Director Rex.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I would like to echo the comments that have been made by the tremendous work that staff did on these documents. It was a heavy lift. And as Alvin mentioned in his presentation, our goal is to ensure that residents in the area have an opportunity to participate and get service from Dr. Cog and our members. And we've applied for a couple of various grants to help our ability to provide some additional translation services and the like. We weren't successful with those, but it reaffirmed our commitment across the organization to invest in tools and programs like this. And we're really where we'd like to get is to build the capacity and expertise in this area so that we can specifically offer opportunities for our members, so that we can offer some type of translation service to our members, most notably our smaller members, who might not have the resources to be able to do that, to provide some translation services of their own. So stay tuned on that. We're going to talk more internally about that, but we'll have a program in place sometime soon. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Director Rex. Thank you. Seeing no other comments, all those in favor, please say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed, please say no. Any abstentions? Thank you, everyone. The motion carries. That takes us through our action items tonight and into our informational briefing. So just a reminder, the first topic we have is expected to take a good amount of time to make sure everyone gets their questions answered and up to speed, so that we will be able to take action on a DRCOG board position at our following meeting. So we're not going to formalize a position tonight, but we do need to clearly articulate what direction staff can move in so they can bring us back a documented position on this next time. And so because this is going to be so meaty and hefty, I'm going to keep track of people who have commented and try to ensure that, you know, people get a chance to speak that maybe haven't commented yet. So just kind of be mindful of that and maybe try to keep a couple running tally of questions or comments so that we give everybody a chance to have time on the floor. And with those reminders, I'll turn it over to Ron Papsdorf in director of something, sorry, Ron, transportation. You'll introduce yourself, Director Papsdorf.
There are lots of days, Madam Chair, when I don't know what I do either. Thank you very much.
Sorry about that. Director of Transportation Planning and Operations.
Good to be back with you again to continue our conversation on the greenhouse gas emissions rulemaking proposal from CDOT. So I will start with the presentation. Let's see, you should be able to, should be seeing that now in presentation mode.
Yes, we are.
Okay, I'm gonna zip past that title slide real quick. I'm gonna try to get through this. We had a, you know, we've had a couple of conversations now with the board. I hope you're getting a little bit more familiar with the rule, but I just wanna remind folks of kind of the goals for tonight, continue our conversation, give you again, sort of the remind you of the context of the rule, some questions and staff perspectives on some components of the rule and set the stage for continued board discussion and ultimately direction to staff on kind of how we move this process forward. Just a quick reminder on the schedule. We're in that 60-day written comment period right now, scheduled to end on October 15th at this point. The Transportation Commission anticipates taking action or considering the proposed rule for adoption at its November 18th meeting here in a couple of months. Just by way of context, again, you know, I think it's important, and especially with the folks that are providing public comment to the board, staff is really approaching this from the position of reviewing the rule very carefully and offering options for the board to consider and ultimately for CDOT and the Transportation Commission to consider to make the rule better. DRCOG has adopted goals to reduce greenhouse gas emissions related to surface transportation. That's in our Metro Vision plan. It's adopted by the board. We're supportive of those efforts. We think about that in every decision we make, and we just want to approach this rulemaking in a way so that the rule is effective and that we can operate as an agency and as local governments within the rule, considering our overall responsibilities as a metropolitan planning organization and regional transportation planning. But this is not a conversation about opposing the rule. This is about, are there opportunities to enhance or improve the rule to make it better for everyone and for us as an agency? And again, this rulemaking stemmed from the passage of House Bill 19-1261, where the legislature set statewide goals for reducing greenhouse gas emissions from all sectors. The state subsequently prepared a greenhouse gas pollution reduction roadmap that was endorsed by the governor earlier this year, that established how the state would make progress towards those greenhouse gas emission reductions. And then just this year, the legislature adopted Senate Bill 260, which in addition to new funding for transportation through fees and otherwise, also set new requirements for CDOT to develop guidelines and procedures for both CDOT and MPOs related to transportation planning and projects in the context of greenhouse gas emission reductions. again, there are two sort of, there are lots of definitions in the rule, but two key definitions to keep in mind. The applicable planning documents to which the plan applies, those are MPO RTP adoptions and amendments, and the CDOT 10-year plan adoption and amendments, the CDOT 4-year prioritized plan adoption and amendments to it. That's a subset of the of CDOT's 10-year plan. And then MPO TIP adoptions in the DRCOG and the North Front Range MPO areas, but not the other three MPOs in the state. Regionally significant projects, which is referred to in the rule, for the purposes of this rule and our DRCOG federal air quality conformity determinations in the DRCOG area, these definitions are basically major new roadway capacity improvements in the form of roadway segments, roadway widening, new or converted managed lane facilities, a mile in length or longer, and then new interchanges on freeways or otherwise, or interchange capacity improvements, and then new or dedicated rapid transit lanes, rail lines, rail line extensions, or new rail rapid transit stations. And again, those rail lines and extensions greater than a mile in length. Additional context, just a reminder for folks, DRCOG is in its function as a metropolitan planning organization, does have specific responsibilities and in how we coordinate the regional transportation planning process under federal law and regulations. So we're responsible for sort of setting, providing the setting for effective regional transportation decision-making. We identify and evaluate alternatives to meet future transportation needs. We have to prepare and adopt long-range multimodal regional transportation plans covering at least 20 years. We have to update that at least every 4 years. And then there are specific mandated planning factors that we have to consider. Among them are air quality and economic development and the condition of the transportation system. Lots of those considerations that are told to us that we have to consider in our planning process. We prepare and adopt a transportation improvement program, and very important, we and as you just saw from Alvin's work, we're very serious and we take very serious our responsibility to involve the public and our stakeholders in that planning process. So get that out of the way and move quickly, just the rule components. This is amending existing rule. There's a preamble that sets some context for the rule. There's a series of definitions. There's some language around that affects just CDOT on the statewide transportation plan. And then some language about amendments to the regional and statewide transportation plans, not substantive to this process. The meat of the rule related to greenhouse gas emissions is the new Section 8 in this rule. There's the establishment of the targets. There's a process for determining compliance. There's a section on mitigation measures. There's a section that talks about the Air Pollution Control Division confirming and verifying our work. There's an enforcement mechanism, and there's some reporting requirements. I'm kind of a visual person, and so we took a stab at trying to put our interpretation of the rule into context in the form of a process flowchart that I hope might be helpful to the board in thinking about this. As I get to the slides talking about specific components and some of the discussion items and some of the options for consideration, thought it might be helpful for the board to think of kind of the overall process first and have a sense for how the process might work. So I'm gonna make an attempt at this where we continue to refine how we talk to the board about this. So I hope this helps. This, again, this is a DRCOG product. This is our interpretation of sort of how the rule flows and works, not necessarily endorsed or confirmed by CDOT, but I think it's a pretty good sense of how the process works. So when we're doing something like adopting a regional transportation plan, the rule requires us to prepare an emissions analysis. We do that for each of the horizon years in the rule, 2025, 2030, 2040, and 2050. The rule asks us to compare those emission results to those table one baseline values. We then prepare a greenhouse gas transportation report that includes the emissions analysis and demonstrating that the plan's compliance and is in compliance with the reduction targets. Basically says, do you meet the greenhouse gas reduction levels or not? If you do, you submit your greenhouse gas transportation report to the commission. And then the commission moves into the enforcement piece. So I'll talk about that. If not, then the rule says that you should utilize, in our case, congestion mitigation and air quality funds, CMAQ, and surface transportation block grant funds, SDBG funds on projects or greenhouse gas mitigation measures that reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and CDOT 10-year plan funds for regionally significant projects have to be used on projects that reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So that's kind of if your plan doesn't meet the reduction targets, then kind of you could do this. If in fact you're using some of those funds for mitigation measures to meet the reduction levels, then you also prepare a mitigation action report that you submit along with the greenhouse gas transportation report to the Transportation Commission. So that's how you get back to the commission there. In addition, if we use funds for any mitigation measures, after we've done the mitigation plan, then each year we have to prepare and submit an annual mitigation measure status report to CDOT. So that moves us into the enforcement process. So the Transportation Commission then reviews the greenhouse gas transportation report that's prepared by the MPO, in this case, Dr. Cog, and they make a determination about whether they agree that the Table 1 greenhouse gas emission reduction targets have been met. If they agree yes, then they accept the greenhouse gas transportation report by resolution, and that ends the process. If not, then the Transportation Commission restricts the use of CMAQ and SDBG funds to projects or mitigation measures that reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and CDOT 10-year plan funds for regionally significant projects to projects that reduce greenhouse gas emissions. If the commission has made that determination, then there are two options that the MPO would have. The first option would be within 30 days to basically say, well, we don't really agree with your determination. Here's some additional information, and we're asking the commission to reconsider its original decision. And then the commission has 30 days or it to its next transportation commission, whichever is later, to approve that reconsideration or to act on that reconsideration. The other option is that you can request a waiver for specific projects. One project, two project, a handful of projects, and the commission can consider those waiver requests. And the only way they can consider approving those waivers is first if they determine that significant efforts been made to meet the reduction levels through mitigation measures and other projects. Kind of, you've done everything you possibly can, and we still think there's some important projects that should be funded. So that's the first screen. The second screen is whether the waiver would result in a substantial increase in greenhouse gas emissions compared to the reduction levels. If it meets both of those screens, then the commission may waive the restrictions on specific projects. Again, the rule is that within 30 days or the next Transportation Commission meeting, the commission acts on the waiver or the reconsideration request. One point in the rule that I think we've noted in our review of the rule is that the commission, basically, if the commission doesn't take any action, doesn't act on either of those requests by that time frame, then those requests are deemed denied. I think one thing we're thinking about is probably the commission should have to go on record on their decision one way or the other. So that's the process overview. I just wanted to give you a sense of sort of how the process flowed. And I want to go back to the presentation real quick to continue the conversation. If I can again. Okay. So quick reminder, this is the table one that we referred to in that process diagram that sets out the baselines for each of the horizon years and the reduction levels. Those are set out for each of the five MPOs and the non-MPO, the remaining non-MPO part of the state. We've seen that before. Again, the compliance piece talks about adopting or amending that applicable planning document. We talked about the analysis, including the regionally significant projects. That's important. I'll get to some of that in the discussion item. We estimate the total CO2 equivalent emissions, compare that to the baseline. There is a provision in the rule, which we agree with, that we think is really positive about consultation and agreement between the MPO, CDOT, the Colorado Department of Public Health and Environment on our modeling assumptions as we're doing our work. I think that that's a consultation process that's very similar to what we do with the Environmental Protection Agency and federal agencies when we're doing federal air quality conformity. I think this is a really important piece of the rule. And again, just a reminder, the way the rule is proposed, this process does not apply to amendments to the TIP. By October 1st of this year, remember under Senate Bill 260, CDOT is required to update its 10-year plan. Dr. Cog and North Front Range are required to update their regional transportation plans. After October 1st, for each of the applicable planning documents, you'd have to meet the corresponding greenhouse gas reduction levels, and that would apply to all of the MPOs and CDOT around the state. Prior to at least 30 days before adopting a new plan or amendment to the regional transportation plan or a new TIP, we provide the Transportation Commission that greenhouse gas transportation report. The transportation report is that analysis demonstrating compliance. Another component of the rule is that if we're using any funds towards mitigation actions, again, annually by April 1st, we provide a status report to the Transportation Commission documenting the implementation status, the timeframe, the quantification of benefits on each of the greenhouse gas mitigation measures. So one of the questions we've been considering and thinking about is, you know, is calling planned bike, pedestrian, complete street, other sort of non-regionally significant projects that are included in our plans, that are funded in our TIP, that are included in our regional transportation plan, does calling them greenhouse gas mitigation measures subject them to that annual reporting? And kind of the answer from CDOT appears to be yes, if they're called out by the MPO as mitigation measures. We have some questions about how we manage that. And part of that relates to that compliance piece, that analysis piece that only focuses on regionally significant projects. Again, we kind of feel like we should include other non-regionally significant transportation improvements that are in the plan in that analysis. So relating to that analysis piece where the language in the rule only speaks to regionally significant projects, we think that we ought to be looking at the totality of our planned investments in the plan so that we have an accurate depiction of the results of all of the investments that we plan to make. And there, in our regional transportation plan, there are significant amounts of investments in projects that are not regionally significant projects. Remember that definition, roadway capacity projects, transit capacity, kind of fixed route, fixed guideway transit capacity project. So all those other things that we invest in, like complete streets, regional bike and ped facilities, those things we ought to account for in our modeling and in our analysis so that they aren't classified as mitigation measures because they're just planned improvements. Again, on the mitigation measures section that allows CDOT and MPOs to utilize approved greenhouse gas mitigation measures to offset emissions and demonstrate progress. Again, referring back to the previous conversation, some of the examples in the rule include additional transit resources, improved pedestrian and bicycle access, land use measures like encouraging local adoption of land use plans for vertical development, zoning, mixed use, improving first and final mile access to transit, changes to parking and other development policies that encourage walking or transit, medium and heavy duty vehicle electric charging and fueling infrastructure, establishing clean construction policies and adopting TDM practices. And again, looking at this list, many of these things are things that we invest in. They're included in our plan. And but some are mitigation measures for specific projects like clean construction policies. So some of the questions that we've been thinking about is, you know, how and by whom are mitigation measures approved? This says that sort of CDOT establishes an ongoing administrative process for selecting greenhouse gas mitigation measures. You know, we're not sure that a statewide process might fully reflect the fact that some mitigation measures are more appropriate in some areas and others might have different effects and different kind of improvement benefits in different areas than others. And so one option that we might consider would be to revise those sections of the rule so that it clarifies that MPOs select the mitigation measures if we determine they're necessary. And we select those rather than sort of having CDOT establishing that process for selecting mitigation measures. Many of what the rule calls greenhouse gas mitigation measures are just planned investments. They're things that we plan to invest in our plan during the course of the plan. They're things we invest in our TIP. And so in the context of a 30-year regional transportation plan, which again is not just looking at a 2050 horizon year, we look at intervening horizon years as well that align with the rule. So we look at a 2030 horizon year and only the improvements that we can afford to invest in and plan to invest in that first 10-year period, and then between 2030 and 2040 and between 2040 and 2050. But these aren't mitigations in the context of the regional transportation plan. And so if we're not specifically calling them mitigation measures, if we can analyze them as part of the plan, then we don't think we should sort of report on them annually, especially for projects that are planned to be invested in out in between the years 2040 and 2050. That would just be an annual exercise and just continuing to list still out there. We still plan to do it. Nothing's changed. So one option that we think might be an improvement to the rule would be to require sponsors of any regionally significant roadway capacity project to identify and include greenhouse gas mitigation measures with their project, what they will do to help minimize sort of the impacts of those projects on greenhouse gas emissions, including, you know, when we're including those projects in either in a TIP or in the STIP. Chair Stoltzman, should I stop at the end of compliance and offer an opportunity for a conversation, or do you want me to get through the enforcement piece first?
I think go through the enforcement piece first and we'll take them both.
Thank you very much. So we've gotten through that compliance piece. We're moving into the enforcement piece. We've submitted the greenhouse gas transportation report to the commission. The commission determines compliance and sufficiency of any greenhouse gas mitigation measures. If the commission determines that the requirements have not been met, then the commission shall restrict the use of CMAQ and SDBG funds and CDOT 10-year plan funds in the MPO area. On projects and approved mitigation measures that reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Then the MPO, CDOT, or a non-MPO TPR may request a waiver or ask for reconsideration. The request for a waiver on specific projects not expected to reduce greenhouse gas emissions on the following basis. We talked about those when I went through the process diagram. So one question we've been thinking about is, should the rule restrict the use of all CMAQ and SDBG funds if the requirements of that section have not been met? There are specific federal requirements and regulations for the use of CMAQ funds, congestion mitigation and air quality. Restricting the use of CMAQ funds as proposed in the rule may limit our ability to address federal air quality non-attainment issues. So there are, you know, we're not in attainment for ozone in this region, nor is the North Front Range MPO area. Might there be situations where there's a project that's necessary to help address federal air quality conformity that might not be beneficial from a greenhouse gas emission standpoint? But should we still be able to use CMAQ funds on those? Because we also need to address that federal non-attainment issue and get ourselves into attainment for ozone at the federal level, restricting the use of surface transportation block grant funds, SDBG funds on projects that reduce greenhouse gas emissions may limit our ability to invest in safety and operations and reconstruction projects that aren't regionally significant. They aren't adding roadway capacity. They probably aren't increasing greenhouse gas emissions at all. Many of them may actually help greenhouse gas emissions, but does restricting our ability to spend SDBG funds on those projects make it harder for us to meet our other federal regulations and address the full spectrum of transportation needs that we are responsible for meeting as a region? So language in section 8.02.5.1.2 and 8.05.2 isn't particularly clear about whether all CMAQ and SDBG funds would be restricted or only some. One option would be to clarify that language so that only those funds specified by the MPO for specific projects according to that section are restricted by that enforcement mechanism. One of the other questions about the waiver is the language in section 8.05.2 is a little bit unclear about whether CDOT can seek a waiver for a project within an MPO area. I believe that the intent of the rule is that waiver requests would have to be submitted by the MPO. We would simply suggest that there's an opportunity to revise the language to just make it very clear that only the MPO can seek a waiver within an MPO area. Obviously, If CDOT and the state believes very strongly that there's a project that is of such significant importance that it should go forward, work very closely with them to accommodate a request to move a waiver. But I think we think the aligning the language with this with the intent of the rule so that those waiver requests only come from the MPOs is an opportunity. Another question is, does the rule require MPOs to get a waiver from the Transportation Commission to invest federal funds on non-regionally significant projects? So again, if we're not quite meeting the reduction levels per the rule, the commission restricts our use of SDBG funds and CMAQ funds in the through Dr. Cog. Should we have to ask for a waiver for non-regionally significant projects, a safety project, an operational project that doesn't have any impact on greenhouse gas emissions, but again, is very important for achieving our other goals. So an option would be to revise that language to state that the restrictions are for specific regionally significant projects not expected to reduce greenhouse gas emissions so that we can still invest some of those federal dollars on projects that are still very important to the regional system, but are not regionally significant, are not adding vehicle capacity to the system. Finally, just we'll summarize real quick some of those options that were highlighted in the slides that we've seen over the last couple of meetings. Again, this is the intent here is to try to improve the rule and improve the success. The opportunity for success in the partnership between CDOT and MPO in implementing this rule and achieving our mutual goal of reducing greenhouse gas emissions. There may be an opportunity to set the baseline in a Transportation Commission policy directive and reference them in the rule so that they can be updated more frequently without opening up the rule. This may be important as the State Demographer's Office updates employment and population data for the region and might change the baseline from what we think the baseline is today. In a couple of years, maybe population employment forecasts change a lot and the baseline would then change a lot because of that. So having an opportunity to revisit those could be an improvement to the rule. The other option would be to clarify in the rule that we're meant to basically have our plan achieve the baseline minus the reduction level. Basically, you're setting a target for maximum greenhouse gas emissions related to the plan. So that might be another way to do that, where kind of setting the baseline might be a little less of an issue. I know there are different opinions among board members about this, but you know, one of the things we have talked about as an option is to sort of remove transportation improvement programs from the plans that are subject to the rule for reasons we discussed at the last meeting. It's a very short-term investment strategy. It has to be under federal law and regulation consistent with the RTP. If the RTP has already shown compliance with the rule, we're not seeing a lot of value from kind of moving the tip through that process. We agree that it's very important, as it always has, to think about the air quality impacts of project investments from the plan when we're making those short-term investments in the TIP. But sort of running that subset of projects that are already in the RTP through this process might not be as much value, especially when you're still looking at the horizon. You're out to 2050, and really you're looking at just a very near-term sort of investment. So everything else is in the plan anyways. Another option might be to amend section 8.02.1 so that it's clear that that analysis can take into account other non-regionally significant improvement projects that are included in the plan. We talked about that. Revising section 8.02.3 and 8.03 to clarify that MPOs are responsible for selecting mitigation measures as we determine appropriate and necessary. Require sponsors of regionally significant roadway projects to identify and include greenhouse gas mitigation measures when those projects are included in a TIP or a STIP. Clarifying the language about only those funds that we specify for specific projects are restricted. Revising the language to clearly state that MPOs are the ones that seek waivers in an MPO area. And then again, revising 8.05.2.1 to state that the restrictions are on specific regionally significant projects not expected to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and allowing us to continue to invest in other non-regionally significant projects like safety projects without seeking a waiver from the commission. That's probably, Chair Stoltzman, a good place to stop for discussion, if you agree.
Perfect. So what we're looking for is to be able to get to a place where we can give staff direction tonight on what to bring us back for our DRCOG position. So staff has just now laid out a number of options where we could give input to help strengthen the measure. And they were labeled as options throughout this. Remind you that they're in attachment F in your packet if you're following along. And we do want to hear from everybody. And so if you have suggestions on moving these options forward for our comments, that would be useful. Or if you have any other questions or comments, those are appropriate now too. Director Odorizio.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Thank you. I appreciate this. I think you did an outstanding job, Ron and team, really laying this out. There's a lot of detail here, a lot of questions that could come up. I think we all need to move toward improvements in greenhouse gas emissions. And the only the things I think that you brought up, but I also want to reiterate, are what we got to make sure is that this body here, DRCOG, does not allow the Transportation Commission to override some of our decisions. I'm worried about the authority potentially being circumvented and the purpose of DRCOG by going to the CDOT Transportation Commission. So if we can kind of lean in on that issue, I think it's important to remember that we there's a purpose for DRCOG in this process. And so I just want to, how do you recommend we frame that so it doesn't just look like a turf war, but also a legitimate question about whose lane is what, how far, whose authority goes in this? And then I have a second follow-up question after that.
Director Papstorf?
Sure. Director Odorizio, thank you. The regional transportation process that metropolitan planning organizations are responsible for coordinating, and coordinating is the key. It's not unilateral, and it's designed to not be unilateral. It's designed to be cooperative. CDOT and RTD are equal partners in that process. We are the three primary agencies responsible for that regional transportation planning process. It's just that the MPO makes the decisions, but with those partner agencies arm in arm with us, and we work really hard at making sure we do that. And there are occasions when CDOT doesn't think we do a good enough job, and there are times when we think CDOT's sort of stepping on our toes a little bit, and we work through those issues, and you know, and they can be tough sometimes. And Rebecca will back me up on that, I know. But really, that is the way that the process is designed, and I think you know we're very cognizant of those issues, and that's why you know staff has sort of highlighted some of those issues about sort of our MPO responsibilities. In the regional transportation process, because we don't want to forget about that. We don't want to forget about the fact that there are lots of things we have to consider when we're doing regional transportation planning. Air quality is absolutely very, 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 very important, as is safety, and as is having a well-maintained and operated system. Like all of those things are important. And so I think the DRCOG staff at this point feels like, you know, with some of these options that we've thrown out for the board to consider as potential comments or some version of comments, we think that that will help sort of balance those out.
I appreciate that. I'm hearing that the very collaborative nature of our relationship should help in that. And I hope that that comes out at the end of this process. The second question, Madam Chair, if I might, was one of the things I have concerns about, also even within our DRCOG family here, is just to make sure that although Denver and the Boulder kind of corridor and those areas have, you know, kind of grown and they've kind of been built out in many ways, there are still a lot of us in on the surrounding areas, even on the outer rim of DRCOG, that are still continuing to grow. And I want to make sure that we keep that message out there within DRCOG, but also to see that there's a lot of, that we can't just have a bias against capacity improvements. Simply for the sake of having a bias against capacity improvements, because in some ways, and I'm thinking of things like 270, having being able to relieve some of the congestion and the idle time and the slow, improving efficiencies can also help with greenhouse gases. So what I wanna make sure that we do is that we don't penalize certain of the outer rim or the outer jurisdictions because of maybe some inequities and resources, inequities in environmental justice. I wanna make sure that as we really work toward making sure that these rules, as well as our own internal processes, don't create systemic biases that continue to drive a wedge between those who have resources and those who do not. And so I really don't know how to put that into any better words than just saying, let's just continue to work towards that. But I just want to make sure that that the criteria that is established here, that the rules that are established here, don't hold back those jurisdictions that still need to grow and improve efficiencies. On the other hand, I also think we need to lean into not looking at capacity improvements in the same way we have in the past. I'm okay with embracing multimodal and integrating bike and ped and these other alternatives together. So I think it's a balance. I just want to make sure that there's a lot of jurisdictions in on this call that still have some growth and need some efficiencies.
Thank you, Director Odorizio. Director Brockett?
So, Ron, thanks so much for evaluating this so closely and coming back to us with some really focused sets of recommendations. It's a complicated, very, very complicated topic, groundbreaking, and really appreciate what you've done. It is a comment on the complexity of it that when you boiled it all down, it was like a 2-page long flowchart, right? There's a lot there. I got a couple questions for you. Do you mind backing up 2 or 3 slides, please? One more. There we go. This one.
There we go.
There we go. Okay. So I get your point here about potentially being able to still use some CMAQ and STPG funds for air quality mitigation, as I understood your point, even if maybe you're not in greenhouse gas compliance, that we also need to work on the air quality non-attainment area. So that makes sense to me. The option here, though, is a little opaque to me because of the reference to the other kind of rule points. Would you mind just saying that in more plain English, what you're proposing there for an option?
Sure. So. Yes. So 8.05.2 is in that enforcement section of the rule. So that's where if you're not fully meeting the greenhouse gas reduction levels, then the commission can restrict the use of those funds. 8.02.5.1.2, sorry for the long cite there, is that piece in the compliance section where, you know, after the MPO has done its emissions analysis, if we're still not quite meeting the reduction targets, then it says you can utilize a portion, or you can utilize SDBG and CMAQ funds on projects that reduce greenhouse gas emissions or greenhouse gas mitigation measures. So those are the two sections that this is referring to. So the suggestion is to clarify that language so that you don't have to necessarily restrict all of those funds to those types of projects, right? That you, if in the case of 8.05.2, if the commission is restricting the use, then similar to how the language is structured for the 10-year plan. So the language in that section, if you remember, it's an and 10-year plan investments for regionally significant projects. So that's the language when it's referring to the 10-year plan investments. I think that it might make sense to mirror that language when it comes to restricting an MPO's use of CMAQ and SDBG funds, also related just to regionally significant projects, so that the MPO still would have the flexibility to use a portion of SDBG funds and CMAQ funds on other projects that address other important regional priorities like safety or our federal air quality conformity determinations or operations or maintenance, right? Kind of capital maintenance, reconstruction sorts of projects that are important to just keeping the system operating and in decent shape. Does that help clarify that for you?
It does help, yeah. And so then, thanks for that. So my comment related to this would be, when you come back to us with specific proposals, you know, for comments, would be to really flesh that option out into more plain English, and then maybe I agree that we also need to be mitigating our ozone non-attainment and other air quality issues. But my personal thought would be that you would want to keep that exception list pretty limited to only the most critical non-greenhouse gas related projects. So, you know, air quality makes sense, safety makes sense, but I'd keep that list limited, would be my personal comment there. Next question, if I may. So I know there's language in the rules that there are certain things that only Dr. Cog and the North Front Range MPO are required to do. Do you know offhand what that list is?
Update our regional transportation plan by October 1st of next year. So that's one. We are the only ones that TIPS are an applicable planning document, I believe. I have
that's
to go
correct,
back.
Ron.
Pardon me?
That's right.
Thank you, Doug. Sorry, it's late and there's a lot here.
So those two things?
I believe that's correct.
Okay, great. Well, I'll roll into another comment here, if I may, Madam Chair. I'll just reiterate my comment from last time. I know you heard me, but I do feel like it's important to include the TIPS in it as one of the documents that's subject to the greenhouse gas evaluations. I think, as I said before, we may or may not get to all the projects in the 10-year RTP. And if we only get to the ones that increase emissions and don't get to the ones that decrease them, then we have a problem. And this is really our biggest lever, is where we spend our dollars. So I get that it would be, you know, there'd be challenges around it and it's a more limited scope, but I feel pretty strongly that it's important to include that the TIP is an applicable planning document and continue. So I would not recommend that request to change in our comments, and I'd be interested to hear maybe from some other directors whether they agree or disagree. But one point on that is, it seems like we might also advocate for the other statewide MPOs to have those similar requirements. I mean, I think we were chosen because we're in non-attainment on air quality, but these are greenhouse gas emissions, and it's a separate question from air quality. So I don't know if maybe we might put that in. It might look a little self-serving, but it seems like a reasonable change to ask for, that the other MPOs have some similar requirements. So I'll put that out there for consideration as well. And then if I can just make one more comment, if you could indulge me, which was, I think last time Director Levy mentioned the idea of translating, having a translation between greenhouse gas reductions and VMT reductions. And that made a lot of sense to me, that it's more quantifiable in certain ways. It might be a way that would make it easier to evaluate smaller projects and their impacts. We might be more easily able to quantify VMT impacts than GHG reductions. So I thought that idea had a lot of merit and would be something worth considering recommending to CDOT. That's what I got. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Brockett. Director Maurer?
Oh, Madam Chair, may I interrupt for just 1 second?
Director Papsdorf, yes.
I had a phone a friend moment, and shout out to Rebecca White for helping my memory. The other thing that is unique to Dr. Cog, North Front Range, and CDOT in the rule is that we are the only three entities that are subject to the first horizon year of 2025 in compliance. So the other three MPOs don't kick in until the 2030 horizon year. So thank you, Rebecca, for the reminder. I appreciate that.
Thank you, Director White. Yeah, so I'd include that as well. I mean, it seems like we should all five of us be getting on this stuff sooner rather than later. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Brockett. Director Maurer?
Thank you, Chair. And thank you, Mr. Papsdorf. Yeah, you're great at putting this stuff together, and it really helped a lot, those added information and your flowchart. I guess the one thing I'm looking at, and I'm not looking at right today, I'm looking to the future. And I'm just kind of wondering, when we're looking at these mitigation measures and the list of them, is there going to be a weighting or you know, like do you get points more for one thing versus another? And I did like that the MPO would have that opportunity to look at those mitigation measures and wait, or like just look at them. So anyway, is there any way that they're doing that or looking at that?
Yes, and the provision in the rule around the mitigation measures, sorry, I'm trying to get to it in the presentation real quick, it does set out a requirement for CDOT to go through an administrative process to explore mitigation measures by April 1st of next year. And so that is a component of the rule. You know, what shape that takes, I think, is, you know, we're not entirely sure, but the rule does speak to that. But again, the issue that sort of we're raising is, and there's probably an opportunity to clarify that through that administrative process, but, you know, some mitigation measures might be more appropriate or more effective in some areas than others. Will there be flexibility for MPOs to sort of determine what the impact is of mitigation measures if we determine we need to use them, depending on its situation, the different situations of the MPO? So that's kind of the issue. And again, I think an overriding issue that staff has raised is that, you know, calling bicycle and pedestrian improvement projects a mitigation measure in the context of a plan doesn't sit. Mm-hmm. It's hard for us to sort of think about, because we just plan those improvements. Now, if you're doing a major roadway capacity project, a reasonably significant roadway capacity mm-hmm. project, then maybe some additional local bike and ped connections to connect neighborhoods, that's a mitigation measure for that project. Okay. We don't think pedestrian and bicycle investments in the system in the context of a plan is a mitigation measure.
Okay. Oh, that's very helpful. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Director Maurer. Director Levy?
Yeah. Thank you, Madam Chair. And I'm going to pile on here with the kudos to Ron Papsdorf here for his incredible analysis and efforts to explain all of this and distill it down for us. And I'm still trying to get my arms around a lot of the provisions in here. And if you could just leave the mitigation measures slide up, that would be really helpful. But first, I did want to support Director Brockett's comment that we should be looking at having all of the MPOs in Colorado be subject to this the rule in their planning processes at the same time, given that the greenhouse gas emission reductions are really unrelated, although maybe there are some spillover effects, but the non-attainment and greenhouse gas reductions are different things. So I support that as well as his other comments. And thank you for bringing up again VMT reductions, because I think it'd be helpful if staff could bring back maybe a suggestion and some proposed language for incorporating targeted VMT reductions into the greenhouse gas MMT reductions somehow, since it is a much more reliable proxy. So just on the mitigation measures, I'm just having a little bit of trouble understanding how these would be considered. And I don't think there was anything in the rule about whether these mitigation measures would be part and parcel of the project that is being scored. We keep bringing up 270 as an example. And so if the increased capacity on 270 cannot meet the greenhouse gas or the plan, if it includes those, I know we're not scoring individual projects, would the mitigation measures have to be part of that project, or could they be completely independent? And then I guess another question is, for those things that are on this list that are, the land use in particular, that are not really things that we're going to be able to look at here for compliance, how would we assure that these things are actually done and that our funding decisions are going to be dependent on the plans being not only just adopted as plans, but then implemented? Because, you can put a master plan together that has walkable neighborhoods and dense development and all of that, but that plan may not be fully realized for 20 years or so. It's subject to development patterns and market forces and things like that. So I think I need to understand a little bit better how some of these mitigation measures are actually going to be linked to the plan, to the transportation plans, and how there's going to be follow up to make sure that they're implemented.
Mr. Pastor.
Madam Chair, may I?
Please, definitely.
Yeah, thank you, Director Levy. Appreciate your comments. I'll start with the mitigation measures, because you're raising some important questions. So I pulled up the specific rule language about the mitigation measures and sort of when assessing compliance with the greenhouse gas reduction levels, CDOT and the MPO shall have the opportunity to utilize approved greenhouse gas mitigation measures. I think that's part of the reason for the annual reporting requirement, although there's no enforcement mechanism in the rule about, well, if you've identified mitigation measures but you never implement them, there's no sort of enforcement mechanism there. I think to your broader point, MPOs largely we don't implement projects, right? We fund projects, we fund programs, we implement some programs, but largely we're not in the implementation business. And I think that's part of our option that staff has proposed, is considering sort of, require mitigation measures anytime you're approving funding for a reasonably significant project, but associated with that project specifically, so that then you can enforce that requirement as part of that project, right? And overseeing that project, and that project sponsor is responsible for implementing those mitigation measures along with the project, and would be a condition for receiving funding either through the state outside of an MPO area or through DRCOG, or if the state was implementing a project within an MPO area. So to us, that's the purpose behind that option, is sort of tying mitigation measures specifically to projects. The land use stuff we've talked about before, it's a tricky issue. In the state of Colorado, land use is very much the sole purview of local jurisdictions, cities and counties. And now I'm not advocating this, but you know, one way to sort of enforce that would be you're not eligible for TIP funds, say, unless you have reviewed and updated your land use plans around identified transit stations to allow mixed use development. I don't know what that might be, but you know, but still, as you point out, a local jurisdiction can adopt all the plans it wants to. There's a fair bit of sort of market, private market and development market sort of realities about how successful those plans will be or how long it might take to actually reap the benefits of those changes. There are other sort of land use related issues that aren't sort of about land use code or general plans, but it's about development standards and design standards. So, you know, there might be some things where, you know, a local jurisdiction could adopt things like new development along a transit route can't have parking between a building and the street, so that people don't have to wade through 2 acres of surface parking to get to their destination if they choose to take transit and make transit more accessible. I mean, I don't know what the right answer is there. I think we've tried to sort of stay out of the land use piece in our review of the rule for obvious reasons. And we don't know what those opportunities or solutions might be. So, does that address your mitigation measures piece? Because there's another one of your comments I want to talk about too.
Well, it does. If I could, just because there was a lot there, just maybe more specifically on the land use issue, because you know, the Transportation Commission's rule is what interjected this. And in the modeling where they show that we can reduce greenhouse gas metric tons by, you know, whatever the amount is, they're relying on land use as part of that that modeling and those assumptions. And so it just worries me that it's so vague and we're acknowledging what we've all known forever, which is that land use is local. And so I think maybe we could consider whether metropolitan planning organizations can include land use in its scoring criteria in some way as a way to, you know, see that that's done, because otherwise we're left with the other two factors that were incorporated into this.
Yes, and very much, a time when we've talked to the board recently about the next TIP policy for the 24 to 27 TIP, we've talked about, you know, how have we in the past, and how can we in the next TIP cycle sort of consider land use when the board is considering investments through the TIP, and that there are certainly opportunities there. The VMT comment, Director Levy, is an important one, and I will say from your staff, I think we have pretty serious concerns about inserting VMT into this rule. The House Bill 1261 talks about greenhouse gas emissions reductions. We share that goal. We want to do everything we can to do that. But it's not a reduced VMT law. It's a greenhouse gas emissions law. And our concern about introducing VMT is that not every VMT is the same. And while you're right, there's a correlation between VMT and greenhouse gas emissions, it's not perfect. And there are, you know, you can have the same VMT in a very congested situation and lots of vehicles sitting in traffic and idling and producing emissions, or you can have that same VMT moving at a pace that's less congested, and that same VMT is actually producing less emissions than the VMT under congested conditions. And so, you know, that the emissions modeling takes that into account. And so, and we don't, and I guess we feel, the staff at Dr. Cog feels pretty strongly that VMT, introducing VMT in the rule, doesn't help us achieve the rule. And it sort of detracts from the issues at hand, which is reducing greenhouse gas emissions. And there may be situations where a project does modestly increase VMT at a regional within the regional scale, but it makes such drastic improvements in the operations of the transportation that it has a net benefit to greenhouse gas emissions. And we think having that flexibility to assess those situations is important.
Thank you. And I'm aware of those concerns, and I appreciate the difficulty of that. I would just note that reducing VMT is number one. Well, the addition of transit resources to displace VMT is up here. And so it can at least force the examination of what kinds of measures would maybe foster more transit, more multimodal projects. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Director Levy. And now we have Director Peck.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just want to echo what everyone else has said to Mr. Papsdorf, that this is an incredible presentation. And I know it took an awful lot of work. I especially liked your going through the flowchart, as that was very difficult to understand and it made a big difference. I have several questions, so hopefully some of them may have already been covered. My first one is that when we're seeking an MPO, seeking a waiver within an MPO, I'm sorry, that the only the MPO can seek a waiver with an MPO area, not CDOT. The rationale for this is so that Dr. Cog can retain local control rather than CDOT. Would that be one of the opportunities?
Director Peck, I think the staff perspective is that, one, we understand that that's the intent. That was the intent when the rule was written. We just think there's not particular language. But second, I think, we wouldn't want CDOT to sort of be able to unilaterally go and seek a waiver for one of its projects in the region, because maybe the region collectively feels like there's another project that's equally important or more important. And we just think we ought to consider any waiver requests within the context of the regional priorities as partners in that process. And that's the only intent behind that clarification.
Okay, thank you for that. My other one is that part of the potential waiver process and how Colorado's greenhouse gas goals are met is that the proposal states that a substantial increase in greenhouse gas emissions won't be allowed. But can you tell us what a substantial increase would be and how can we meet those reduction goals while allowing any increases?
Director Peck, I cannot answer that question. I don't know what is meant in the rule by substantial increase.
Oh, okay. That's very, it wasn't very clear. It's not clear at all, actually. So I guess that's about it. Thank you very much for this presentation. It's a lot to digest.
Thank you, Director Peck. I'll take this quick opportunity just to acknowledge that this is not all my work. I happen to be the face, but there are just tremendous staff resources in Dr. Cog. A lot of us have been working on this, and I have relied very much on the work of and the leadership of Doug, first and foremost, but Brad Calvert and Andy Taylor and Robert Spots and Steve Cook and Jacob Rieger. Lots of us have been working on this. So I appreciate the acknowledgement, but it is certainly not me.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Director Teal?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, Ron, if it makes you feel better, I'm going to avoid complimenting you on this great presentation. Although it was a very good job, and definitely please send our share our compliments with the team. I would like to start first and foremost by actually agreeing with my friend and colleague, Steve Odorizio. I think Director Odorizio made a very important point for both his county and also what we face down here in Douglas County, in that, you know, we do need to be aware that we do have areas that are not, that are in attainment for greenhouse gas emissions, and yet are still experiencing growth. One of the questions, and Steve, I wonder if we could go back to the mitigation measures slide really quick, because I needed just a little more clarification. I know you tried to speak to clarification on this one, but when we talk about our third bullet there, encourage local adoption, more effective forms of, essentially you're talking about land use planning. I mean, in addition to the vertical development and zoning plans, is it too late to make a case once again for reservation of open space, conservation of open space? Because we've had a great deal of work done here in Douglas County to establish the very real effects of conserving open space in our terrain, and how those can be used as CO2, specifically CO2 sinks. Is that specified at this stage of the game, or is that still a land use planning measure that is referred to and not yet exactly specified?
Yeah, Director Teal, we'll take this opportunity. This list is listed in the rule, but it is very clear that they are illustrative examples, and they are not, it's not an exclusive list. So this is these are just some examples, and there was no attempt, I don't believe, by CDOT to sort of try to develop an exhaustive list of all potential mitigation measures. That was just trying to give a flavor of some potential examples of what they think might be mitigation measures. And again, that administrative process that the rule calls out and directs CDOT to engage in and complete by April 1st of next year is the process by which I think mitigation measures will be more fleshed out, and we're committed to working with CDOT through that process to make sure that it reflects this region's perspectives and needs and opportunities.
And so with that in mind, with your comments in mind, I mean, is this something that we need to attempt to define in our comments at this time, or can that be a part of the planning process that culminates in April next year?
Yeah, I think, Director Teal, that can be part of that conversation, that administrative process.
Okay, thank you. When we talked about enforcement measures, Ron, you said something that really kind of caught my attention, but I apologize, I'm not tracking it when we got to the summary. And it's when you spoke about, eliminate, I'm sorry, I can't remember how you referred to it initially, or it struck me as being a pocket veto capability that the Transportation Commission seems to have under those enforcement measures, whereby you talked about, requiring them to come to a decision within that 30-day period or by their next scheduled meeting, because you seem to suggest that as written, there's kind of a pocket veto capability, and you suggest it would probably be within our best interest to suggest a decision. And so I wasn't tracking that though when you got to your summary. Did you capture that in your summary? And can you help me out?
Thank you, Director Teal. It is not in those summary bullets on those two slides, and apologize for that. This was, in my review of that particular section, I missed that. And so it didn't get into this. It's something that I've noticed just more recently. So that was my fault why it's not in this slide deck specifically, but I thought it was important enough to mention to the board this evening. So the language in the rule basically says that the commission shall act by resolution on a waiver or reconsideration request within 30 days of the request, or at the next regularly scheduled commission meeting, whichever is later. So if they don't have a meeting and it happens to be 32 days after the request was received, then it's at that meeting. But it also says that if no action is taken within that time period, the waiver or reconsideration request shall be deemed to be denied. And I think, Look, I spent a lot of my career working in local government, and I think, you know, and working for local elected officials. And I think, you know, just philosophically, I would imagine that local elected officials that have to take hard votes on things all the time, that it might be an issue if the commission can basically deny a waiver request without actually taking a vote on it and getting on the record for it. And I think I just wanted to highlight that for the board as an additional consideration. And I apologize to the board for not flagging that earlier. It was just one of those things that sort of I missed in my review.
Well, I'll tell you what, Ron, don't beat yourself up too bad. I would very much support that being a part of our comments provided back to the rulemaking commission, because I absolutely agree with you. I mean, I think we've all had to take, everybody on this board has had to take those hard positions in the past, whether we liked it or not, and depending on, of course, on our individual rules and charters, we've had to do that. So I would definitely support that being part of our comment to the rulemaking process. And then I would just like to lastly just chime in my support to support for the use of CMAQ and STBG for use on non-regionally significant plans for those issues that you outlined. The one that stood out to me was safety. I'd be really upset to find out that we had a safety issue that was allowed to extend on when we could have addressed it on a regionally significant project with STBG and CMAQ monies. And not be able to take that action to take care of a safety problem and the operational problems that you also outlined. So I would like to voice my support for that to be part of our comment. Madam Chair, that concludes my questions and comments.
Thank you, Director Teal. Director Mulvey.
Hi, yeah, thank you. My main comments are on the questions that you provided, because I'm guessing that that's what you asked for direction on. And I'm guided by what was previously said. So first, I want to thank you for distilling it into questions on pages 27 and 28, and I'll weigh in. On the first one, with respect to baselines, I'm still concerned that the baselines are not defined and the measures of greenhouse gases are not equitable or lack equity. And I think it's important to look at exactly how they're measured. That being said, I would favor the suggestion and allow the MPO to make the refinement. On the second item, with respect to the option, I believe, yes, we need to make sure that the RTP and the 10-year plan are consistent. They are already consistent, rather, and I think that we need to make sure that the decisions flowing from this rule are consistent with the RTP and 10-year plan, and therefore it makes sense to go with your option and allow that consistency to go through. And so my vote on that is yes. On the next one, that one concerns me tremendously, and I'm not in favor of it, but I think I need more information, because the non-regionally significant transportation improvements and whether or not that's included, I'm not really sure about how I feel about that because of the waiver. But it concerns me that if we go with that option that you're proposing, we're going to lose parity with some of the areas that Directors Odorizio and Teal were referring to. On the fourth one, I do believe that the MPO should select mitigation measures, because it should not lie in, as much as we want partnership, we can't have an unpredictable process. And so if the MPOs select the mitigation measures, then we know that there is consistency in the process, and a process that we've relied on with our MPOs, Dr. Cog, for a very long time. And then I'm going to address the next page that you asked for input on. My vote on that one is no. I still think I need more information, though, because I'm not quite sure why we would change things and require the STIP or TIP to be included. My vote on the next one is yes, I think there has to be parity and consistency between the two steps, which I view this structure, this scheme, this legislative and administrative scheme as being two-step. And I think that we have to have parity between them. And I think that's what you're going for in that one. And so I would agree, yes. On the next one, you say that with that one, I agree, yes, but I have another question. You say the issue is again, whether and the MPO should be the one to seek the waiver. But I would really love to know why you would recommend that CDOT also should not have that opportunity. On my first, well, I shouldn't say first read, on my way many time read of this thing, my view is that, as I mentioned before, we want cooperation, but we also want the predictability of what we know works with our MPO, Dr. Cog, in that process. So that's why I would rather the MPO make the selection. And then on your last question.
Sorry, Deborah. I was just going to ask, if you'll pause, I'll come right back to you. But if we could get Ron to chime in on a couple of those, I think then you could have a little bit of a back and forth to get some of your questions answered. So if we can just back up a tiny bit and ask Director Papsdorf to tell us about what you were thinking about when you suggested including those non-regionally significant improvements.
Sure. Thank you, Chair Stoltzman and Director Mulvey. So the proposed rule language seems to limit the analysis that's required to only looking at reasonably significant projects. And I think the point we're trying to make here by expanding that language to clarify that we have the ability to also include in that analysis other non-regionally significant transportation improvements that are included in the plan. So for instance, in the current 2050 regional transportation plan that you all adopted earlier this year, there are a host of planned investments that are really important to the region in terms of investing in regional multi-use path systems to build out that regional system, in complete streets investments to really rehabilitate existing surface arterials to make them more multimodal. Those projects are not regionally significant, but they represent significant investments that you all included in that 2050 plan. We want to be able to analyze those to show whether that plan is achieving the reduction targets or not, rather than only looking at the regionally significant projects and then thinking of all of those other investments that we're committed to making as mitigation measures. That's the point of that recommendation.
Well, I greatly appreciate that, because I think I just didn't get that one aspect. So I would then change my view on that to, yes, I do believe that all of the projects should be included on the analysis of whether there's compliance, both at what I view as step one and step two of the scheme, so that we have the greatest ability to really assess broadly what the compliance is. So thank you for that.
And just going through your list, then the next one was on the info on the STIP and the TIP. It was on that slide. And Director Papsdorf, do you want to just give us a quick summary about what you were thinking there?
Sure. Just, I think the staff was really thinking about, you know, the notion here is that, you know, when we think about mitigation measures, that really is sort of a project level issue, that there, you know, when there are regionally significant roadway capacity projects that need to be invested in, and sometimes there are, but they should be required to include mitigation measures. And we think about this sort of, if any of you are familiar, when you're implementing a big major project, there can be a federally required environmental assessment or environmental impact statement. And those are to identify all of the environmental impacts of the project and require specific mitigations to either avoid those impacts, reduce those impacts, or offset those impacts in some other way. And we think, you know, requiring a mitigation measure, if a project sponsor wants to build one of these projects and the region agrees it's an important project, before we fund that project, before we move that project forward to implementation, there should be a commitment from that project sponsor to implement mitigation measures to help minimize any air quality impacts from that project. So that's the notion behind that.
Thank you. My two comments on that would be that it comes dangerously close to changing the mandate of the statute. But secondly, while I see that it is in line with the prior one we just discussed, my concern is that some of the projects that fit this description in the STIP and the TIP are significant statewide. And if you require, but the sponsor is local. So for example, Castle Rock's making a change to an I-25 interchange, but that's going to impact interstate commerce throughout the state and commuting and travel throughout the state. And, you know, with the PEL, the impact for the PEL alone was $60 billion economically. So to require the single sponsor of that project to then say that it's going to mitigate something in that particular locale of Castle Rock, for example, and that's going to impact the entire state, just doesn't seem that there's equity there and who's got to do what. Thank you. And then let me know if you want me to go on to the last two.
That would be great. That would be perfect. Thank you, Director.
So on page 28, your last one was whether or not to restrict it to regionally significant projects. I agree with that one. It should not be any, it should be as you read it. So I do agree with that one. And then lastly, on the one that was just discussed with Commissioner Teal, I do have grave concerns about when you allow for denial with no action. And this, all it makes me think of, and pardon me everybody, but what it makes me think of is the fact that if you purchase a handgun and there's nothing done in the 3-day waiting period, the person who may be dangerous can still buy the handgun. Now, a lot of people have a problem with that. So if we keep this provision in there, you're basically saying that that's okay. And I just simply don't agree with it. And I believe that process should be removed. And then lastly, I agree with what Directors Odorizio and Teal said. And thank you for clarifying, Director Teal, with that the mitigation measures are to be determined down the road.
Thank you, Director Mulvey. Director Dyack.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Man, I really appreciate everybody's comments. I've been silent most of this discussion, trying to take everything in. I'm an analytic, so 1 + 1 usually equals 2, and I'm looking for a quick and easy solution on this, and I don't think there are any. But just to address what Director Odorizio said, I believe a lot of the subregions or the counties in the outer ring do have existing zoning in place. It'll be very hard for us to undo that or to zone up to more density without causing legal issues. So the nuance of trying to create more efficiency as we grow should at least be considered, if not talked about, to strike a balance with reducing the emissions as well. With this topic, we're trying to change behavior, and in changing behavior, you need time, education, and money. And the gentleman who had public comment, he was alluding to the fact that there's a gap even with our current modeling. I'm going to go Jerry Stiegel, and I'm going to talk to Director Papsdorf and wonder if there's a way we can articulate the assumptions that we put in the modeling. For example, if a large majority of our single occupancy vehicles need to be EVs, could that be used as a measurable, with the target being put in place to achieve whatever goal that we have to get to? Same thing about mass transit increase. I think that would be interesting to identify what those assumptions were, how we got to that that modeling exercise to get closer to achieve the goals set forth in the state policy. So, I mean, with that, it would be incredibly interesting to see if we could make strides or identify or other partners who could help us out. Some of the people in the outer ring, such as Parker, we do have RTD, but our services is challenging. You know, we would need to build ridership and build it fairly aggressively, I can only assume. I think we are game for it, the elected officials here in Douglas County and Parker. The question is, how do we do that? How do we get RTD to advocate and further that? I'm just using that as an example. I'm not trying to put RTD in a spot. So with that, those are my comments, and thank you again.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So it's basically 9 o'clock. And so we've given some good feedback tonight. And just as a reminder, we'll be acting on this at the next meeting, likely, unless the Transportation Commission is so kind as to grant an extension so folks can get the data they've asked for. But we likely will be acting on this at our special meeting, which will be Doug, when will the special meeting be? First Wednesday in October.
It's October 6th, I believe.
October 6th. And so tonight we've given a lot of feedback that indicates staff should bring forward a position that includes their options. There was some disagreement around whether or not to include the TIP. So I think we should be prepared to have that full discussion at the next meeting. So think about that. There was one suggestion to add one thing that was not an option, and that is to add a comment into our comments around the term significant increase. That should be clarified. So we should add in language around that per Director Peck's comment. And so with that, that'll move us toward being able to take a position at the next meeting. I think there is an elephant in the room that directors have identified an area and asked for additional information. And I know our staff's working on it, but hasn't been able to get it because of a holdup at CDPHE and other places in the state. But there's been this question about the reasonableness of the target in the table. So that's set for our area. And so I think that warrants some discussion at the next meeting as well. I think we all agree. I think it was Travis, the member of the public that spoke to us the last two times, that we're off track, that this is very dangerous for the health of our communities and others, but that there's a question from our board as to what we have authority and control over and what we have funds available for. So we may be in a position where we need to raise the alarm that we're off track to hit our target and that we don't have the resources to achieve it. And so that doesn't mean we should just sign up to achieve it and not be able to get there and penalize our communities for it. So I think we need to answer that question about the reasonableness of the target that's been set for our area and understand who bears the cost of those assumptions that were in the table, like the increase in transit and things like that. That, of course, our board doesn't, that's not within our purview. So I think we need to understand that next time. So between those two topics, I imagine that will take the majority of the time next time. Are there any things else that I've missed in the summary of what staff should bring back for us on this topic? All right. Thank you, everyone, for the engagement. And again, as always, if you have questions in between this meeting and next meeting or things come to you in the middle of the night, please do send them to staff and they can work through those. And if you have questions where you need to have conversations outside the meeting, I'm happy to get coffee with anyone. I know staff is happy to meet with anyone. We should be talking to each other and figure out how we can solve this, because this is the problem of our generation to solve. So that takes us to our next agenda item, and I'm going to recommend that we move to continue the agenda item 13, which is, item 10, update on the FY 2024 to 2027 TIP policy to the next DRCOG board meeting. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion on continuing this item? All those in favor, please say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, everyone. The item has been continued to the next meeting, and we put on the agenda that we'll just hold committee reports till next meeting. I'll remind you there are a couple of informational items in your packet, so do take a look at those. There's really good information in there, and sometimes people feel like they don't have all of the information everyone else does. It's in your packet. The staff puts a lot of time and energy into these things, and they only give it to us if we really should be reading it. And so our next board meeting is October 6th. It's a special meeting, so please make sure that you're able to vote and have talked to your communities before you come. Are there any other matters by members? All right, seeing none, we are adjourned. Thank you, everyone. See you next time.
Yeah, bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Be safe.
Bye.
Night.
Oh, arrivederci.